an off-season surrounded by outside noise. They've cut too deep. Too little experience, they said.
But they don't have a list that's going to allow them to win as many matches as they would have had they kept those players.
But from the confines of Hawthorn's four walls, our young Hawks buckled in and got to work. Determined, ambitious and unwavering in belief, there was a growing sense of optimism that this was the group to forge the next golden era of our great club. Following our largest national draft haul in more than a decade, a new head Hawk was anointed as captain, tasked with leading our next generation on the journey ahead. While our opening fortnight might have been one to forget, our first victory in round three injected an enormous shot of confidence to set us on our way for the season. A harsh lesson in resilience was to come, as the Hawks suffered a pair of heartbreakers, overrun in the dying seconds in back-to-back outings.
Sam Mitchell and these brave Hawks.
While important weeks of growth and learning followed for our young group, our next win was well worth the wait. After dismantling the Eagles in Launceston, the Hawks came from the clouds to send the Saints packing. Skipper James Sicily dragging his side over the line in an inspirational 43 possession performance.
Siren! The Hawks in a big upset. They kicked the last five.
It was a side that was steadily growing in stature, and only a fortnight later, our boys beat up on the Premiership fancy Lions on a Saturday afternoon to savour at the MCG. Three wins in 4 weeks was just reward for the hard-working Hawks as the wider football world began to buy into the belief that had long been instilled among the brown and gold faithful.
Sam Mitchell and his vision seems to be on
track. It'll still be bumpy from here, but it took courage, what I love.
Despite ensuing losses, Seamus Mitchell joined Josh Weddle as our second Rising Star nominee, highlighting the talented nucleus of baby Hawks taking flight in 2023. Speaking of highlights, they didn't come much bigger than this. The upset of the year, our boys putting the pies to the sword in a retro round to remember.
A bit more like Coleman, but that is what Hawthorn have put back at them all afternoon and evening.
Following a pair of statement wins in the final month of football, many in brown and gold were left with a feeling of wanting more, further fueling the journey ahead for this special group of players and coaches. So tonight, we gather to crown the 2023 Peter Crimmins Medals. Will James Sicily join the likes of famous names in Shane Crawford, Jason Dunstall and Sam Mitchell in claiming back-to-back crowns? Or will it be the runner-up just 12 months ago, John Newcombe, completing his meteoric rise from mid-season draftee to the top of the podium? Incredible dominance of Will Day, to James Warple recapturing career best form, and Connor Nash making the leap to midfield bull. All efforts worthy of earning the club's ultimate honour tonight. For now, Hawks fans, sit back and enjoy what promises to be an enthralling vote count following a year filled with so much promise.
Bye-bye. Please thank Uncle Ronnie Murray on the beautiful Yidiki didgeridoo performance. I am Chanel Chandler. I'm a proud Wurundjeri Woiwurrung of the Kulin Nations, and I thank you for having both of us here on the beautiful Peter Crimmins Medal tonight. I am a beautiful Wurundjeri Woiwurrung of the Kulin Nations, and we are standing on the very lands of the Wurundjeri Woiwurrung people. On behalf of my elders and Aunty Joy Murphy, Uminjika, Wurundjeri Balak, Yemenkundibik, welcome to the traditional lands of the Wurundjeri Woiwurrung people. Nojkuma, thank you.
To have you joining us. What a wonderful way to kick things off. So thank you once again to Chanel and Ron. Can we give them another round of applause, everybody? That was absolutely beautiful. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the 2023 Peter Crimmins Medal. My name is Nat Edwards and I will be your host for this evening as we crown our best and fairest player for this year. Now, if you look around the room, we seem to be missing some fairly important people. In fact, they are the people that we're here to celebrate tonight. So if you could please make welcome your 2023 Hawthorn Football Club AFL playing group.
Please welcome your 2023 playing group, starting with number one, Harry Morrison. Number two, Mitch Lewis. Number three, Jai Newcomb. Number four, Jarman Impey. Number five, James Warple. Number six, your captain, James Sicily. Number seven, Ned Reeves. Number eight, Sam Frost. Number nine, Chankworth Jack. Number 10, Carl Amon. Number 11, Connor Nash. Number 12, Will Day. Number 13, Dylan Moore. Number 14, Jack Scrimshaw. Number 15, Blake Hardwick. Number 16, Lachlan Bramble. Number 17, Lloyd Meek. Number 18, Max Lynch. Number 20, Chad Wingard. Number 21, Cooper Stevens. Number 22, Luke Groost. Number 23, Jacob Kuschitsky. Number 24, Denver Granger Barras. Number 25, Josh Ward. Number 26, Fergus Green. Number 27, Ned Long. Number 28, Cam McKenzie. Number 29, Jai Sarong. Number 30, Sam Butler. Number 31, Connor McDonald. Number 32, Finn McGuinness. Number 33, Tyler Brockman. Number 34, Bjorn O'Hara. Number 35, Josh Morris. Number 36, James Blank. Number 37, Josh Weddle. Number 38, Max Ramsden. Number 39, Emerson Jekka. Number 40, Seamus Mitchell. Number 41, Josh Bennett. Number 42, Bailey McDonald. Number 43, Jack O'Sullivan. Number 44, Henry Hustwaite. Number 45, Clay Tucker. And number 46, Brandon Ryan. Ladies and gentlemen, please give a round of applause for the 2023 playing group.
Well, what an entrance. I was trying to work out who got the biggest cheer when they walked out. I think it might be James Warple just. Well, what an awesome turnout we have here tonight at Crown Palladium. It's so great to see you all. I think there's about 1,200 of you in the room tonight, which is amazing. And not only have we sold out this room, but such was the demand for a ticket tonight. We're actually live streaming into households of thousands of Hawks all across the country. So a very warm welcome to all of you who are at home right now. On behalf of President Andy Gowers and his wife Anna, our board members and CEO, it is my great pleasure to welcome Gwen Crimmins, her family and guests with us here this evening. This night, of course, is synonymous with the late, great Peter Crimmins, with the medal, of course, bestowed in his honour. So a round of applause, please, for Gwen Crimmins and her guests. A warm welcome, too, to club legend Michael Tuck and his partner, Faye, who are also here tonight, as well as our number one ticket holder, Emma Race. And of course, a special welcome to our past and current players, their partners and families, club staff, foundation donors, Inner Hawks, 3122 members, confreres, Thornbirds, cheer squad, supporter groups, and most importantly, of course, our members. Now, this year would not have been possible without the support of our major partners, and we are so grateful to all of them, and our portfolio of partners is definitely the envy of all the other AFL clubs. So welcome and special thank you to tonight's presenting partner, Ringers Western. We would like to thank our naming rights partner, Tasmania, Premier Partners, IINet, Nissan, KFC and Ryman Healthcare, as well as Platinum Partners Sketches and ISC for their ongoing support. Thank you also to our wine partner, Hidden Sea, and beverage partner, Carlton and United Breweries, for your support this evening. If we could have a round of applause, of course, for all of our partners, because without their support, none of this would be possible. Now, of course, tonight is all about crowning our 2023 Peter Crimmins medalist and recapping the season that was, but we also want to involve every single one of you who are here tonight and have a little bit of fun. So firstly, we have our Forecast the Finishes competition. So if you guess the correct order of the top five finishes for the Peter Crimmins medal, you will go into the draw to win a 2023 team signed Indigenous Guernsey. So the way you do this is you just need to grab your phone, scan the QR code on the flyer on your table and fill in your top five. So entries are going to close at the end of the entree break. So make sure you just grab your phone and do it now. I've already done mine, so make sure you get on board. We're also running tonight an online auction where you'll find various types of signed Guernseys and Hawthorn memorabilia. Now, the online auction closes tomorrow at 7 p.m. So you scan the second QR code on the flyer and you can start bidding for that. Ladies and gentlemen, we also have some exclusive items available only for guests here tonight. So you will have received a ballot bidding form at your place. In this catalogue, you'll find some amazing memorabilia and special take-home goodies. So you just need to fill out your details on the top of the form and write down your one-time maximum bid on the items you would like to win. And you can give that form to the staff from Helping Hand who are currently moving between tables. And if you do have the highest bid of all the guests here, you will receive a text message at the end of the night. Bidding for that closes at 9:30, so make sure you don't miss out. Shh. Thank you. Love a good shush. Last but not least, we do have a raffle tonight. So you will find the gold bags placed on your tables. Please support the club and buy a raffle ticket or two. The first prize is an amazing QT hotel package, which includes one night's accommodation and a QT deluxe king room, including breakfast for two, valet parking, and a sparkling on arrival, if you don't mind. So all other prizes can be found on your on the flyers on your table. Credit card slips are included in the bags in case you don't have cash, and tickets are $10 each, 3 for $20 or 8 for $50. So you might as well just get the 8 for $50 and get it out of the way. If you didn't get one on your way in, we actually have a $100 draw tonight, and we're selling only 100 tickets for this. So this is your chance to win a 7-night stay for 10 guests in a beautiful Bali villa valued at over $5,000. So that's $100 for a week-long holiday. It's an absolute steal if you win it, and probably the best 100 bucks you're going to spend. So you just need to select your number between 1 and 100. First in, best dress. Make sure you see our Hawthorn staff at the registration desk in the foyer to buy your ticket as soon as you can. We will draw this at the end of this evening, so please be sure to hurry over to the registration desk as it usually sells out. Alrighty, there is a lot happening here tonight, plenty of ways to get involved and have a little bit of fun, but for now it does give me great pleasure to welcome to the stage the president of the Hawthorn Football Club, Andy Gowers.
Good evening all, and thank you very much, Nat. I'll begin by acknowledging the traditional owners of the land on which we are meeting tonight and pay my respects to their elders, past and present. What a sensational job Nat Edwards does and does continue to do through the year across our many functions throughout the season. It's brilliant the way she effortlessly keeps the show on track. Please join me in thanking Nat Edwards. As Nat has mentioned, a very warm welcome to every single one of you here tonight, including all of our special guests who have already been welcomed, but I'd like to in particular welcome the Crimmins family, represented here tonight by Gwen, Ben, Emma and Sam. Please give another round of applause. I know how special this evening is for all of you, and it's always wonderful to see you. I'm told we have right on 1,200 committed Hawthorn people here in the room tonight, as well as thousands more watching via a live stream at hawthornfc.com.au. Hello to all of you. It is absolutely fantastic to have you all along for the ride, and what a great night we have in store for you. My first Peter Crimmins medal was 35 years ago in 1988. It was at Leonda in Hawthorn, and it was a very different occasion from tonight's glamorous and large celebration of the 23 AFL season for our mighty club. Although I must say, just like 1988, it's very reassuring to see long hair, and in particular the mullet, is back in style. Hello to Jai Newcomb, Connor McDonald, Bailey McDonald and Josh Weddle. There's clearly a lot of hair product doing a lot of work. I'd like to congratulate our playing group for their efforts this year and wish our contenders good luck in the race to be voted this year's Peter Crimmins Medalist. It promises to be a thrilling vote count. While the season delivered plenty of highs and lows, there was one constant that remained each week, and that was the hard work and sacrifices made by our wonderful group of players and coaches. The commitment and dedication among this group is really something else to behold. It's hard not to get excited when you see the bond and connection being built among our players, all pushing each other to get better and better. The best example I saw of this year, those strong bonds building nicely amongst our playing group, was the day we knocked off eventual grand final runners-up, the Brisbane Lions. Wasn't that a good day at the footy? Although, Mr. Sicily, skipper, it was also the same day we learnt a game-defining tackle could get you suspended for 3 weeks. We'll leave that for another day. Anyway, after the final siren that day, and after our players acknowledged our members and fans around the MCG, the boys gathered at the top of the race and waited for the final player to join them before going down into the rooms and singing our theme song. While they were waiting, a dance song came over the loudspeakers, and without prompting, nearly all of the players started dancing on the ground. My wife, Anna, commented, "Players, you really look like you are all at a 21st birthday party." Such natural joy was experienced that day and highlighted to me the connection among our group is strong, and in bad news for our opponents, it's only getting stronger. Our victory over eventual Premiers Collingwood was further evidence of this. And again, yes. And once again, I think that was an even better day at the footy. We know 2024 will be another important year of development under Sam and all the coaches, but I already can't wait to see what our talented and fearless young group can achieve in the years to come. The rest of the competition is officially on notice. We are on track and we're coming. I'd like to mention one of the biggest changes we've seen at our club this year in the appointment of our new CEO, Ashley Klein. After interviewing and considering a number of very impressive candidates through a rigorous and extensive process, Ash emerged as the clear choice. His intimate knowledge and passion for this club is second to none. There he is. He has a proven track record of success in delivering for our club during his many years as our Chief Commercial Officer. And more recently, he selflessly stepped up and took on the interim CEO role during our time of transition and performed brilliantly. I'd like to wish Ash well in his new role. He's a terrific person and has bled brown and gold since the day he was born, or close to it anyway, making him just the person we need to be leading our club into the future on the exciting journey we have ahead of us. As good as it is to celebrate Ash's in-house ascension to the highest position in our club of CEO, it's equally important to pay our respects to Hawthorn people who have sadly passed away over the past 12 months. To the families of Paul Sullivan, Dr. Peter Scott, Rodney Horrocks, Brian Horskins, David Ulberston, and Maury Young. Once again, our thoughts and condolences go out to you from your Hawthorn family. There are so many things that make our club great. And in my view, the most important element is our people, our members, our fans, you. I take my role as chief volunteer very seriously and love being at the club, mingling with staff, players, past players and officials, and our many volunteers. I love going to games and listening to members. Your feedback about what you love about the Hawks and what can make us better still. It takes all of us united to be the best club in the AFL. In terms of how important you, our members, are, I want to highlight the enormous impact you have on our club. A great example of your direct impact was our huge attendances at the MCG this year. We averaged more than 50,000 attendees at each of our MCG games. This is the highest number we've had since 2015, our last premiership year and the last of the three-peat era. I know the players love playing in front of you. And as we rise up the ladder to play finals again, playing in front of big, loud numbers of brown and gold members and fans will be really important to our future success. This is in addition to our home matches in Tasmania, where we have a significant impact in the greater community through our numerous programs, in addition to our performance on match days. And I'd just like to remind everyone, we won 3 out of our 4 games at UTAS Stadium this year in what is a very happy hunting ground for us. But as a club, we are incredibly grateful to you, our members, as you stick by us through footy's natural ups and downs. Astonishingly, we had more than 80,000 members again this year. Yeah, that deserves a round of applause. It deserves a round of applause, and it's an achievement and justified proof of your pride in our club. Notably, our AFLW membership base is one of the biggest in the competition, despite the fact we are only in our second year. Season 2023 could not have happened in the way that it did without you. We cannot wait to see and hear you in the stands and see you at club events in 2024. When Collingwood won the grand final last Saturday, they joined Essendon and Carlton on 16 premierships each. We have won 13. I think a worthy goal for us is to reach the point where we have won more flags than any other club on our own. Wouldn't it be amazing, and won't it be amazing, to be the most successful club in the VFL-AFL competition despite only entering the VFL in 1925, decades after the Pies, Bombers and Blues. I can hear the late Lou Richards say, gee, the Hawks were late starters in the AFL, but by golly, look at them now. I'm sure you'll all agree. In closing, it's important not to lose sight of the significance of the Peter Crimmins Medal and the ability for all of us to come together as one club. Players, both current and past, staff, corporate partners, our cheer squad, coterie groups, members and supporters to celebrate the year that was. We have representation here across our netball, VFL, VFLW, our 2 blind teams, our 2 wheelchair teams, AFLW and AFL programs. How special is that? Congratulations again in advance to all of our award winners tonight. I hope you all have a fantastic evening. I look forward to seeing you all again very soon, maybe even on the dance floor. Go the mighty Fighting Hawks.
Get that back down to my height. Thank you so much, Andy, and a round of applause too for Andy for all of the work that he's done in his first year as president of the Hawthorn Football Club. All right, we are now going to take a short break for entree, and when you return, we're going to hear from our senior coach in Sam Mitchell. Please enjoy. Welcome back, everyone. I hope you enjoyed your entree. If you haven't already taken your seat again, if you could do that in the next 30 seconds or so, that would be fabulous, and then we can get underway with the rest of the evening. Thank you, everyone. If you could take your seats now, please. All right, thank you so much. Appreciate that. Now, if you haven't done so already, don't forget to grab your raffle tickets and also fill out your ballot for the auction. And before we head down memory lane and relive the 2023 season, it is now time to hear from the man that has led our team so incredibly well this year. So if you could please put your hands together and welcome to the stage our senior coach, Sam Mitchell.
Thank you all, and welcome to the Peter Crimmins Medal. I think when you work inside a football organisation, it's very rare for you to spend too much time looking back and reflecting. And tonight is a night on the calendar we look forward to as coaches, as players, as staff, and as fans to look back on what has happened over the last 12 months, and in particular during the season. And I'll start with taking you back around 12 months ago to the start of the season. We'd been through a trade period, a free agency period, and I think everyone in the room will remember the noise around the club at the time. And not a day went by where there wasn't an article or something written about us, about where we were going to finish. I know Dylan Moore, who is on the loudest table down here, so he keeps a notebook of comments of people that don't believe in us. And part of what my job has been in my 2 years so far is not just to show our players and our staff the direction we're going, but it's also to bring all of you on our journey. And for us, the plan has been really clear. And we spent a lot of time thinking about it, developing it, and now we're in the execution phase. And I think bringing the fans on the journey and the members on the journey has been a key part of what we've been able to do so far, and something that we have been proud of. And you'll see flicking up over the next little period while I'm talking up here some photos of our shared journey. There'll be photos of the start of the season. And if I take you back to that period, in round one we played our arch rival Essendon, and I think the two things people say to me the most, Hawthorn fans, please, can we just beat Essendon? And the other one is, please, can we just beat Geelong? Okay, so I don't know why you're cheering, we lost to them both. But we played Essendon in round one, and we had 9 players who had not yet played one season of football. 9 players who had not played 20 games. And what that meant was they didn't have the experience for the moments that were needed. And you'll see that photo there, the pain from the early phase. And we understand on our journey that it's not just us that feels that. I can imagine many of you watching that game against Essendon or the subsequent game against the Swans, where the players were feeling horrible, and I must admit, the just sense of doubt was there. And the great thing about this club is after the Sydney game, I think I spent about an hour. We're at the airport, we're about to fly home, we'd had 2 really bad losses. And I spent about an hour thinking, are we okay? And I went straight back to the strategy, I watched a bit of the game, I looked at the players, I looked in their eyes, and there was absolutely no doubt in my mind that we're on the right track. And what you saw as the season progressed was the growing of this group. You saw players who, it's being an AFL player is a fantastic life, but it doesn't come without its stresses. For those of you who have 9-to-5 jobs, it's very, very difficult to work those jobs with everyone looking at you thinking you're a failure. And what I could not be prouder of our playing group and our football department staff and our whole staff is that at no point did we sense that internally. We brought joy throughout the season and optimism and positivity for such a long period of time against some odds, particularly in that early phase. And those moments that we hadn't experienced, we started to. And what I want to say is, as we made progress through the season, and I think Andy Gowers mentioned already, taking the cheap clap, that we did beat both of the grand finalists. Thanks for stealing that one, Andy. And when you think about those wins at the MCG, 50,000 fans or more, you couldn't help but understand that despite our low ladder position and youthful exuberance and so many moments that you wish you could have again as a playing group, coaching group, staff, I couldn't help but always think that our fans are on board with us. And what I've been most proud of is the fact that we've been able to do it in what I would feel like, I don't think too many clubs can finish 16th and have the full support of an 80,000 strong membership base. And so what I'm really proud of, I'm really proud of the progression that we're making, and I wish it was faster, and I am doing everything I can, and so is every player in this room, every staff member, to make it as fast as possible. But what I do know is we will take you guys on the journey with us every step of the way. And I think the members, they deserve a lot of credit for what they've been able to do. Producing 50,000 people at every MCG game, there's a photo which will come up in a moment of Punky, and it's my favourite. I think I have to throw a shout out to Steve, who had 7 people looking for hours for the right photo. But that was the one. And when I think about Luke Bruce and what he's been able to do for this club, and I look at that photo where he is sharing the joy with you guys, I think about everyone who supports us in our journey in doing what we love. And I'll throw a quick shout out to Lyndall, my own wife, who throws all of her support behind me in having all these rat bags over to our house and making sure they're all, you know, as well behaved as we expect 20-somethings to be. Sam Butler, don't smirk at me like that. But what we do can't be done without enormous amounts of support. And to our, you know, I heard the Warple clan cheer for him before. You know, I hear all of the players, their partners, their families, their parents, but also our staff who work enormously hard. I've been lobbing into the club every now and then, and I wish I could go there and they wouldn't be there, but quite often all the staff are there, they're all working, they're all trying to get prepared for next season. And I want to say just a quick thank you to all of our staff for what they've been able to produce in supporting our players this year. And while we reflect on the season that was, and it's going to be a great count, I literally have 6 players who I think can win tonight. And I'm really excited because I think it will be close and it will be go right down towards the end. So I'm really looking forward on reflecting on the season that was and the count. But I think, you know, the big question is, what do we expect from next year? And I don't have an answer. Everyone always thinks, who's going to win the grand final? And they think that, you know, because we're inside the tent, that maybe we know. But we can't read the future. What I do know is that I haven't seen a more committed group of players and staff who are more attached and aligned to our journey than I have right now. Does that guarantee success? Absolutely not. But what I can promise is we will be fully committed to making this group progress in the fastest possible way to bring you success in September. Because I went to the grand final last week and I was getting so many text messages from our players saying, I just want to be out there. And it's amazing how the world changes, but I got an Instagram connect from Andy Gowers this morning. Wouldn't believe that, would you? But he sent me a note of a golfer, and he was talking about you have to be the guy who wants the ball. And when I think about our playing group and what they're willing to produce, the work ethic that they're willing to do, and I watched a grand final between two teams we've beaten, I thought to myself that we're a long way closer than we were 12 months ago. And that while the next 12 months is going to continue to be progress, I think when I look down at our players, as I've said many times, there's no ceiling and no speed limit on how fast we can get there. But what I do know is we are 100% committed to getting this group and this fan base back to that last Saturday in September. Thanks, guys. Have a great night.
Thank you, Sam. Now, before you go too far away, you've got to come back out here because we would like to reflect on a very special moment that happened earlier this year, of course. I am talking about the moment that Sam was inducted into the Australian Football Hall of Fame. Yes, how amazing. A wonderful moment for the entire Hawthorn family and a great opportunity to pause and celebrate arguably one of the greatest players to don the brown and gold. Now, Sam, there is someone who wasn't able to be here tonight, but they would like to share a very special message. So if you could turn your attention to the screens, ladies and gentlemen, we'll hear from this.
Hi, everybody. I hope you're enjoying the night, and I'm delighted to be here to recognise Sam Mitchell's elevation to the Australian Football League Hall of Fame. I can think of very few other people who have qualified in the manner you have against the backdrop of finding it very difficult to get recruited to the Hawthorn Football Club, and then to have the fantastic career you've had, firstly as a player, then as the captain of this club, and now continuing your great work as the coach of the Hawthorn Football Club. What probably sticks in my mind most of all, annoyed the hell out of me actually, but to have you ring me and suggest that I come and watch you play and write your report. I know you're a neighbour around the corner in Hawthorn, and I used to go off and watch the games as close as I could, have to make my notes, and then I'd go around and leave the report in your letterbox. I think what annoyed me most of all was that you wanted to argue the point about what I saw, but that's typical of you, the person, the player, and you're able to achieve what you have already achieved on the basis of your attitude of continually looking for ways and means of getting better at what you're doing. And that's happened as a player, and I'm sure it's now happening as a coach. Well done.
And now, the captain, number 5, Sam Mitchell.
They've been tough and strong, runs to 50. Sam Mitchell is killing the strong.
It's a shock. It's the only way you can really describe it. Mitchell does better than everybody there. He beat 3 of them.
The Hawks are running better.
Sandilands winning it down. Mitchell roving to him. However,
no contest. The toe poke. Still hasn't come out of the middle. Osmond Farmer stole it but couldn't give it away to a teammate. Mitchell through traffic as he likes to do beautifully. That is superb to watch. Spears the pass to Williams.
And again, Birchall. Handball to Corey. Mitchell, not only the smother, but the gather off it.
Passes. Mitchell, 60 metres out.
Not paid. Tuck. Oh, caught. Holding the ball. A game-saving tackle.
He's working.
Mitchell.
On. Quickly goes on to the left foot. The captain's kicked the goal.
Puts the Swans back in front. Great game.
Mitchell steals the takeaway, though. Short, hook here.
So he passes in between Mitchell and Hodge, who does the shepherding. Mitchell tried to size it all up. Oh, he got it just right.
Hawthorn have kicked the last 4.
Mitchell's got it. They need to be careful here. Barlow, Mitchell steps out of the tackle. But brilliant Mitchell. How's that?
Down.
Now, I know you probably feel a little bit embarrassed right now because you weren't expecting this. You were trying to sneak a look at my notes before and I was like, you can't look at my notes, Sam. A message from Parco, and just looking back at those highlights, now that the cut and thrust of the season is finally over, what does it all mean to you?
It means I'm off you a bit, to be honest. I had no idea that was happening and I apologise to the players in particular. But I must admit I'm not a big one to reflect. I think the only time I reflected during my whole career was my 300th game, when you're able to, you know, spend a week thinking about yourself and your own game and what you've done. But I think I love our game. I think sport is such a great way to bring so many different people together. I have a great mentor of mine who I met. He's a brain surgeon and he spends his whole life cutting people's heads open and saving people's lives and not saving them all. And he couldn't watch a game of football because it made him too nervous. And when I left him a message and said, it's just a game, relax. I think about that person who can't watch a game because of the pressure it brings him, and think about his day-to-day job. I think about all the people that it brings together to be a part of that in history, in the Hall of Fame, is something that is something to be that I'm enormously proud of, but very embarrassed by. So thank you for indulging that 5 minutes of torture for me.
I'm sure you were just more embarrassed about one of the haircuts that you had, the old flop.
I actually rate the hair. I thought it was quite good. Nat.
Well, it did make me feel
it did make me understand. I know Andy already mentioned all the mullets and all the great things that our players are doing now, but I'm sure you'll look back as a 40-year-old and think, what was I thinking the way I am now?
Well, you certainly brought a lot of Hawthorn fans, including myself, a lot of joy as a player. So congratulations. And ladies and gentlemen, if you could please raise your glass. We're going to make a toast to Sam Mitchell on this great achievement. To Sam. Now you can go hide.
I'm going now. Bye.
Alrighty. It is now time to wind the clock back to March and reflect on the opening four rounds of the season. And before we roll the highlights package, I would like to welcome Sahir Khan from AIG Security. Now, Sahir, as you can see, is going to hand over the votes in preparation of the 2023 Peter Crimmins Medal Count. So here it is, tight security.
Thank you, Sahir, appreciate that.
I'll take this somewhere safe. These votes have been locked away in a vault all season, tighter security than the Brownlow Medal. Thanks, ladies and gentlemen. All right, it is now time to get to round one, our opening game of the season against the Bombers at the MCG.
Before we start the count, let's take a look at exactly how our voting system works. Between the Hawks coaching group, there are three voting cards. On each card, a player could receive from 0 to 4 votes for a maximum of 12 votes available per game. Coaches gave 1 vote to players who performed their role or beat their opponent, 2 votes for those who had a significant influence on the game, 3 votes to the best player or players on the ground, and on rare occasions, a player or players might receive 4 votes for an exceptional game. Let's get into the vote count. The Hawks kicked off their 2023 campaign against the old enemy Essendon in front of a massive home crowd at the MCG. Despite leading at the first change, the Brown and Gold would suffer a 59-point loss. James Sicily was gallant in defeat with 30 touches and 15 marks in his first outing as captain. In his return game from shoulder surgery the year prior, James Warple was busy collecting 29 possessions and 7 clearances, while Cam McKenzie was among the votes in his first AFL game with 18 disposals on debut.
Spinning move was superb. How good that? Time to look over his shoulder. Chad Wingard, brilliant.
Going head-to-head against last year's grand final of Sydney on its home deck in an early season road trip was always going to be a tough ask. And sadly, it proved to be just that. The Swans comprehensively outplaying the Hawks by 81 points at the SCG. Will Day was a shining light as he made the most of a move to the midfield in the new full-time role, collecting 29 disposals and 7 clearances. While newly appointed co-vice-captain Dylan Moore chipped in with 23 disposals and a goal.
Moore, quick snap around the corner, and it's a goal for Moore.
Launceston had long been a happy hunting ground for the Hawks, and perhaps it was perfect timing for a round three trip to Tasmania to face the Kangaroos. Two last quarter goals from Tyler Brockman and Dylan Moore proved the difference in the 19-point result, setting up our first win of 2023. Day was again damaging through the middle, racking up 29 disposals and 9 score involvements, while Brockman, in his first game since 2021, combined with Moore to finish with 5 goals and 16 score involvements.
Victory's going to pack an extra emotional punch here, prevailed by 19 points.
A fast start from the Hawks at the G on the Easter Monday blockbuster had the football world in a spin as reigning premiers Geelong stared down the barrel of a 0-4 start. Unfortunately, the Cats came purring back to life in the second half to steamroll the Hawks. Jarman Impey tried gallantly in defence with 24 disposals, including 8 intercept possessions, while Luke Bruce and Fergus Green booted 3 and 2 goals respectively.
It's going to come back nicely. No problem with that at all.
Well, as we look to the leaderboard for the first time tonight, we have an even spread of vote getters to begin the season, with Will Day's solid start seeing him grab an early lead. He's followed closely by Dylan Moore and skipper James Sicily, while Jarman Impey and James Warple all aren't far behind after only 4 rounds.
So there you have it, the leaderboard after 4 rounds. Will Day leading the way on 22. For now, Dylan Moore's up there as well. Fergus Green, good to see him poll early in the first 4 rounds. Really enjoyed watching him play this season. All right, we are going to continue our count in just a moment. But after their resounding success and impact last year, I'd now like to welcome to the stage fan favourites Dylan Moore and Sam Frost to give us an update on our community programs this season. Please make them welcome, ladies and gentlemen.
Thanks, Nat. For those that weren't here last year, Maury and I have been lucky enough to sit as player representatives on the Hawks Community Foundation Board for a couple of years. For those that aren't familiar with the foundation, it delivers direct impact into the community through programs and partnerships made possible by the support of generous donors and government grants. It aims to create change across 3 focus areas, which are First Nations engagement and empowerment, mental health and wellbeing, and social inclusion. We felt it was important to share with our members, our family members, and everyone else here what our engagement in the community has looked like over the last 12 months. At Christmas, we swapped Hope in a Suitcase, an initiative that provides emergency supplies for kids in crisis, for Hope in a Stocking, buying and wrapping gifts to donate to children of various ages living in care. In February, a group of us visited Hillcrest Primary School in Tasmania to help facilitate a Hawks Friends program, which focuses on developing a range of social and emotional skills. The connection with Hillcrest is so important to our football club as their community continues to recover from the 2021 tragedy. More recently, we donated home-cooked meals to the Humble Mission, totaling 120 meals across the playing group. We have also helped pack hygiene supply packs with a company called Pinch of Poo to be delivered through their school hygiene program, supporting 300,000 students suffering hygiene poverty across Australia. In May, before Sir Doug Nicholls' round, we had our boots painted by the talented Ray Cousins and the students at Warrawa College. We also participated in a Learning on Country Day in Emerald on lands of the Wurundjeri people as we continue to celebrate and learn about First Nations culture. We were also proud to be playing in a Guernsey designed by our own Jarman Impey.
As players, we feel very fortunate to have a platform to give back to the community. The game gives us the opportunity to try and win on the field every week, but we also have the chance to build relationships with communities off the field, which allows us to stay balanced. Whether it be attending Hawks for All sessions at schools, connecting with First Nations students, or visiting kids at the Royal Children's Hospital, everyone channels their own passions and energy to have a positive impact. We feel lucky that Hawthorn doesn't just encourage us, but it allows us to follow our off-field passions. A few of us were lucky enough to go to Darwin in June. With some partners, some staff, we're able to learn about the original Aboriginal heritage from the First Nations people. Whether it be trying to start a fire or painting some art pieces, we're able to learn a lot at Top Didju. We even got to go to Ninimalak Gorge and have a nice cruise, and we got to learn about some Dreamtime stories. But for us, the most rewarding piece was at the end, at Barunga, about 2 hours south of Katherine. We got to spend a day with about 350 people that just love life for life. We got to spend the day chatting, relaxing with a tight-knit community who welcomed us as family. This was a community that didn't care about our football. They just care about us as people, and for us, that was the most rewarding piece. On behalf of the players, Sam and I would like to thank everyone in the room who has allowed us to participate in all the community pieces throughout the year. Whether it be Maria, head of the Community Foundation Board, Richard, Brad, Sally, Adam, the community team, thank you so much for your support and care throughout the year. Without you, none of these community pieces would have been able to happen. For all the donors in the room, thank you so much as well. Without your support, none of this could happen. So, can you all now look at the screen for a short presentation on the community pieces throughout the year? Thank you.
Somewhere, you know I care, but it's so cold and I don't know where. I brought you daffodils on a pretty string, but they won't flower like they did last spring. On another love, oh my tears have been used up. On another love. Another love, oh, my tears have been used all. Oh.
The club certainly does some amazing work in the community, and thank you to Dylan and Sam. I'm sure that insight only encapsulates just a small part of the great work that is carried out, of course, throughout the year. So Hawthorn is proud to also have some incredible athletes across our blind, wheelchair and netball programs. And we are so pleased to be joined tonight by representatives from these teams. On table 33, our Hawks netball team have yet again had another strong season in the Victorian Netball League, with the Division 1 team making it through to the preliminary final. And a very special shout out to Championship team captain Kalia Stanton, who is with us this evening and won the league's Most Valuable Player Award. A round of applause, please. Whilst Chloe Duke and Ashley Newham made the Team of the Year in the Division 1 competition, an outstanding achievement. As you can see on stage, we have had a successful season in the Victorian Wheelchair Football League and the Victorian Blind Football League as well. Both teams experience premiership success, which is absolutely amazing. And our 2023 premiers are sitting on tables 31, 33 and 61. So a round of applause for our premiership players. This season, we actually had two wheelchair football teams representing the club, a team in the Victorian Wheelchair Football League and the Community Wheelchair Football League, with a total of 15 athletes playing across the two sides. The VWFL team completed a stunning year of wheelchair football, defeating Richmond in the grand final to claim the club's inaugural Victorian Wheelchair Football League flag. I hear it was a dominant performance after halftime, an amazing achievement and one that our Hawthorn family is so incredibly proud of. So a huge round of applause, please, again for these amazing athletes. Our CWFL team also made history for the club, making the finals for the first time, but unfortunately they went down in an elimination final, but they'll be back again next season stronger than ever. The Hawks also had two teams battling it out in the Victorian Blind Football League. The success of both teams across the season was evident, with Hawks Brown and Hawks Gold going through to the grand final, and Hawks Brown were able to complete the task by defeating Hawks Gold by 27 points. So another amazing achievement by these athletes. So many highlights and so many incredible moments from both leagues this season. Let's take a look.
Gonna make it bend and break.
Send you to me that way.
Say a prayer, but let the good times roll. In case God doesn't show.
Let the good times roll.
And I want these words to make things right, but it's the wrongs that make the words come to life. But who does he think he is?
If that's the worst you got, better put your finger.
Some amazing moments there that we'll remember forever. All right, I would now like to welcome back to the stage Sam Frost to present the Best and Fairest Award to the Hawks Wheelchair Team.
I'd like to now announce the winners of the Community League and VWFL League Best and Fairest Award. The winner of the Community League Best and Fairest is David Ralph. And the winner of the premiership-winning Victorian Wheelchair Football League side, Best and Fairest, is Yasin Hill. David, I'll start with you first. After being a Hawthorn fan your whole life, what does it feel like now to be a Best and Fairest winner?
Well, the best word I could use to describe this is a fairy tale. As you say, I've followed the Hawks since the late 1980s, is when I went to my first ever Hawks game, and I spent many weekends from then on at the MCG, Waverley Park, cheering the boys on. And so from that point of view, it's, you know, it's winning this medal, a medal of, as a Hawthorn player, is a fairy tale. And also, I played wheelchair sport as a youngster. I'm 43 now, so and I played basketball. And then I finished that and I thought my wheelchair sporting days were over. And then wheelchair footy came along and I went to a few come and try days and went from a very low base of not getting my head around the rules and all sorts of things with the wheelchair footy, but got a bit better at it, a bit more confident. And then it all happened very quickly to where I actually got nominated for the draft in 2021, and as I say, it was all very last minute, and I didn't know whether I would be at Hawthorn. I was hoping desperately I would be at Hawk. And I got a phone call to say congratulations. It was actually from Ned, one of the guys at the Hawks, to say congratulations. And I was still in my early 40s at that stage, and that to be a seen in any way as a Hawthorn player at that age is a fairy tale, and to be here accepting an award as a Hawthorn player is just quite mind blowing. So.
Congratulations again, mate! Another round of applause. And yes, incredible year for yourself. You've scored 114 goals. You're now a premiership player. How did you enjoy the year and how do you top it next year?
Yeah, nah. Coming into the start of the season, we didn't know really what to expect. We just about, redid our whole team and, I didn't know what was going to happen and how we'd do. And, we started off the season, a bit rusty. We lost to Richmond by over 130 points in round one. And then, round two came along and we came back from, I think it was about 55 points down at quarter time and beat St Kilda by a point. And then, from that point on, I think that really set our season up. And from then on, everything just started really clicking, not just with myself, but with the rest of the team as well. Everyone, played their role and did a very, very good job. And, here we are, 6 months later, and we've won a flag for the first time ever in our history.
Well, congratulations again to you both. Amazing seasons, and enjoy the night.
Just get a cheeky photo while we're up here. Absolutely amazing. Congratulations again to David and Yasir, and thank you, of course, to Sam. I would now like to welcome back to the stage Dylan Moore to present the Best and Fairest Award to the Hawks Blind Team.
I'd like to announce the Best and Fairest Awards for the Hawks Brown and Hawks Gold. For the Hawks Brown Team, Steve Obeid. And the best and fairest for the Hawks Gold, Ned Brewer Mager. Well done to you both. I'll start with you, Steve. How did you settle into the Hawks this season?
I feel like my first year, I've had an incredible time. Everyone's been so welcoming, and I've just been able to be able to perform how I felt in previous seasons. So I've been able to transition and perform pretty well.
That's great. And anyone you've got to thank?
The club, the team, everyone who's been able to let me perform in my role and to just do our best to get the Hawks Brown into the final. So thank you.
Yeah.
Ned, you've now won multiple AFL Blind Best and Fairest. It's an amazing achievement. And I hear you grew up as a Hawks fan as well. So what does this mean to you?
Well, pretty much, like, hopefully everyone in the room. I grew up a massive Hawthorn supporter, so always would go down to my local oval and run around, try to be Buddy or Cyril or Hodgie or Sam. So for me to have the opportunity to play for the club that I support is such a huge privilege, and it's an amazing thing for me, and something that everyone in the room should be really proud of, that this footy club gives people like Steve, myself, Yas, Ralphie and the Wheelies team as well, the opportunity to live out our dreams. It's something that everyone should be really proud of.
Mate, you're a great asset to the club, so anyone you got to thank?
Just want to thank everyone. I work at the club as well, so all the admin staff and the boys downstairs and the women's team as well. Just thank you to everyone for really getting behind the Blind team and all the teams in the footy club. It's a true privilege to be up here accepting this award, but also to represent this club as well. So thank you very much.
All right, well done to you both. Enjoy the night.
Thanks, Dill. Appreciate that. And congratulations, of course, to Yasin, David, Ned and Steve. I love the fact that the AFL has grown to be a much more inclusive sport, and it's great to see the Hawks are leading the way in that area to make sure our great game is more accessible to all. It now gives me great pleasure to announce our fan-voted awards here tonight. Here are the goal and the mark of the year.
Ned Reeves over the top of Draper, the first gamer. McKenzie looks brilliant. Wingard, spinning move was superb. How good that? Time to look over his shoulder. Jack Wingard, brilliant. Simply brilliant.
This is just textbook centre bounce clearance into some magical play. Just Chad Wingard reminding us just how good he is. That was a special goal.
Words of the great Kevin Bartlett, shades of Baryshnikov. And the Hawks are up by 9 points.
Gannon McKenzie, big fly, Weddle. Nice hanger.
How good is this kid? That's his second.
He's had a cracking game.
Hippie takes up the good work.
So there we have it, our mark and our goal of the year. Chad Wingard and Josh Weddle join me here now. Chad, I'll start with you. Congratulations. I mean, your highlights reel across the course of your career is going to be filled with more brilliance just like that. But talk me through that goal. What was going through your mind?
Yeah, a lot of those moments that happen is just all adrenaline. You're not really sure what's going to happen. But yeah, I was glad that it went through.
Have you ever been compared to someone like a Baryshnikov? I think a ballet dancer. The commentators,
yes.
They compared you to Baryshnikov.
I don't believe I have, no.
Something new for you. I think I speak for most Hawks fans in the room, or all of us, really. When we saw you go down with that injury, we're absolutely gutted for you. You've got the moon boot, you're rocking a cane tonight. Just talk us through how you're tracking at the moment.
Going really well. They had the surgery 6 weeks ago now, so hopefully getting this boot off in a couple of weeks. And then, like I said, it's a bit of a long grind, but just staying day by day. And like I said, like a lot of the boys, just can't wait to get back out there.
Josh, what did you make of Chad's goal?
Yeah, I wish I could do something like that, but as a backman, we don't get the chance to kick too many goals.
Well, you launched and took an amazing mark, I think, in just your sixth game of AFL. Talk me through launching for that one and then coming down. You put a bit of mayo on it when you were limping around.
Yeah, well, I just saw the ball coming in, saw there was a bit of a step ladder, so I went for it. And then, yeah, I think I had a bit of a corky, so thought it would make the mark a little bit better as well.
Chad, what did you make of his mark?
Well, I loved it especially because it was against Port Adelaide, so that made me feel even better.
Yeah, I like that. Josh, what a great season you had. What did you learn about yourself this year?
Oh, a few things.
What?
Oh, put me on the spot. Just the commitment and just trying to get better every day. Just learning a lot from all the older boys as well. So them just teaching me new things and, yeah.
Were you given a license to just run and do as you please? Because I absolutely love watching you just breaking the lines.
Pretty much. Was just back myself in and just take the game on.
Tell them what you've been doing for 3 weeks prior at training, every match sim, you reckon. How many hangers did you try to take in 3 match sims in a row?
Yeah, you're not wrong. But, like, I was like, I think every time after training, it was just specky bag and it was on Jim. I think he'll be here. But, yeah, Jim would be on the specky bag and just... I wouldn't get off until he told me to stop.
Love this. And final question for you, the mullet. Is it here to stay?
I've had it for about 2-3 years, so I don't think it's going anywhere.
Okay, the mullet staying, ladies and gentlemen. Josh Weddle and Chad Wingard. Congratulations to both of you again, Mark and Goal of the Year. Thanks for joining us up here. All right, everyone, we are about to take a break for your main course, but before we do that, it's time to take a look at the highlights from rounds 5 to 10.
They say football can be a game of inches, but the margins were even slimmer for the Hawks in round 5, as a Harry Himmelberg fingernail denied Jarman Impey of a would-be match-winning goal in the dying seconds as the Giants won by just 2 points.
Get there, Olivich! Is it there? Is it not? I'm not sure.
Playing in a picturesque Norwood Oval amid the inaugural South Australian Gather Round, midfield trio Jai Newcomb, James Warple and Connor Nash were Hawthorn's best. Hard-nosed Nash announcing himself among the league's stoppage specialists with 31 possessions, 9 tackles and 7 clearances in a career-best game. Launceston set the scene for our Anzac Round showdown against the Crows, and boy, wasn't it a bone-crunching contest from the get-go. Nash and Newcomb were a dominant force through the middle, combining for 54 touches and 17 tackles. Gun recruit Carl Amon continued his strong early season form with 22 damaging disposals, while Jarman Impey's elite rebounding efforts also didn't go unnoticed. Sadly, it was the Crows who came up clutch, however, plucking a 3-point win courtesy of a sharp-shooting Darcy Fogg.
Another near miss for Sam Mitchell and these brave Hawks.
The return of Mitch Lewis for the first game of the year gave the Hawthorn faithful high hopes for our date with the Dogs. But it was James Warple who had fans out of their seats thanks to his brilliant finish from the boundary.
Lewis to Warple, has he got the shape? He has! What a goal!
The Hawks held a narrow lead at the main break as Ned Reeves commanded the ruck contest over would-be All-Australian Tim English before the Dogs dug in and pulled away to post the victory. Newcomb and Day were instrumental in another solid showing from our midfield, but it was Reeves who was Hawthorn's best, earning himself the first 10-vote game for the season on the back of a career-high 43 hitouts, along with 15 disposals, 6 tackles and 3 clearances. A trip to the West was up next, but sadly yielded yet another disappointing result as the Dockers cruised to an 11-goal win. Connor Nash was among the Hawks who kept trying all evening, laying an equal game-high 8 tackles, along with Will Day, who hit the scoreboard for the second time in as many weeks.
Inside, beats it across today, skips to the side and snaps the goal.
Having paid homage to our emergency services champions, it was the Hawks that needed an SOS against the Demons, managing just 1 goal to half-time. Fortunately, the brown and gold regathered itself to show some spirit following the main break, but it was a case of too little, too late. Skipper James Sicily was great in defence with 27 disposals, including 10 intercept possessions and 8 marks, while 5th gamer Seamus Mitchell pushed his case for a rising star nod with 27 touches and 8 marks.
Career goal, drives it long and deep.
Oh, get on board.
First goal for Weddle. And the Hawks, with a couple of youngsters, get rolling.
While our match against the Eagles in round 10 was billed as the battle of two teams seeking the 4 points, Hawthorn proved it was far too dominant against the struggling West Coast, chalking up the club's biggest victory in more than a decade with a massive 116-point win. With Seamus Mitchell snubbed the Verizon Star nomination a week ago, Josh Weddle ensured he wouldn't be overlooked with 28 possessions and 2 goals in just his 4th game. But it was Mitch Lewis who was the star of the show in a 10-vote performance, booting a career-high bag of 6 goals. While the ever-reliable Luke Bruce chimed in with 3 of his own.
A 22-goal outing. The Eagles without a goal to show for the second half.
Here we go. Some of the key contenders have made their move after 10 rounds with just 10 votes separating the top 5. We've been on single figures in our last update. Newcomb and Nash are now 1 and 2 on the leaderboard, with Dave following closely behind. James Sicily and James Warple are within striking distance, while Jarman Impey, Carl Amon and Dylan Moore all remain in contention.
So a few things have changed since we last checked in with the leaderboard. You can see there Jai Newcomb coming in hot, as expected. 3 9-vote games in a row. I think 31 touches, 10 clearances and a goal against the Giants. Fantastic stuff. Of course, Warple's creeping in there. James Sicily had a good patch during that period as well. And Jarman Impey as well, polling through the first 10 rounds. It looks like a wide open race. There's still plenty more twists and turns to come, I feel. Now, just a note, we have now sold out of the boarding passes. So thank you and good luck to all of you who have entered the $100 draw to win a week's holiday in a Bali villa. Hopefully it's me. Hawthorn staff will be coming around now to collect your gold raffle bag. So make sure you've got your tickets sorted for the raffle. It's now time to take a break for your main course. And just a reminder that ballot bidding will be closing at 9:30 p.m. So make sure you get your bids in. Enjoy your main course. We'll be back shortly. Last year, we embarked as pioneers in the brown and gold. There were golden moments, golden achievements, golden memories, reminding everyone that it's gold that defines us. But gold is also a journey.
Come on.
It's our standards at training. It's the wisdom from those who have come before us and the deafening roar at every stadium we play. Gold is exceptional work. Proof that we're willing to do what nobody else will. And it's so close, we can almost taste it. This is our 2023 season. And our future is gold. Welcome back, everybody. I hope you enjoyed your main course. And if that doesn't get you excited about our AFLW Hawks, I don't know what will. There was glitter all over the office for about, I reckon, a good 2 weeks after shooting that one. And what a season it has been already for our AFLW Hawks. They really took it up to Brisbane last week in what was a really physical contest. We beat the Bulldogs, of course, in round 2, and then unfortunately just fell short against the Saints, although Emily Bates did her darndest to try and pull us across the line today. So there have been plenty of season highlights so far on an individual front. Jazz Fleming has been nominated as for the AFLW's Rising Star Award for the second straight season. Catherine Brown kicked her first AFLW goal, which was very, very exciting. And of course, one of the big highlights was our skipper in Tilly Lucas Rod finally winning their first ever coin toss, Tilly. So well done. We'll talk about that in just a moment. Of course, 4 rounds left to go in the AFLW season, and we cannot wait to see what happens over the next month. But to talk more about the season and what it has thrown up, please welcome Tilly Lucas Rod and our co-vice captain, Jazz Fleming. Welcome to you both. Tilly, you've just come from game. You're rushed here. Did you win the coin toss, by the way?
No, I lost today, unfortunately.
So, have you actually just won one?
Yeah, just the one. And a practice game.
How much did you practice that in the off season?
A little bit. Today I asked Flem what I should call, and she said call tails. So it's actually Flem's fault today.
Okay, so it's your fault. Talk me through the game today. How was it? Because you came home late, and M Bates was doing absolutely everything in her power to will you guys over the line, but just fell short.
Yeah, it was a disappointing loss in the end. I think we played two different halves of football. The Saints really got us in the first half, and then in the second we were able to kind of get back, but it just wasn't good enough to get the win.
Tilly, talk to me about what it's been like playing in Frankston down by the beach. I feel like the city has really embraced the Hawks down there. Have you enjoyed it so far?
Yeah, we love playing at Frankston. I think we had a really nice last training session before round one, and the sun was setting, and you can see out into the ocean. And luckily enough, there was no wind. But we love getting down to Frankston, especially this season. There actually hasn't been a lot of wind. But we think we play a really good footy there. We call it our fortress down at Frankston.
There's been a lot to get excited about. I mentioned a couple of those things before. Catherine Brown kicking her first AFLW go. I love the development of Bridie Hipwell as well. What has been a couple of highlights for you, Jazz?
I think, yeah, definitely seeing Bridie's development this season as our key forward has been huge. She was in my drive class last year, so it's awesome seeing her getting the credit for all the effort she's put off in the off season. And then I think Emily Bates came in and she's just smashing it so far and helping us in the midfield.
Tilly, a month left of the season. What's the mindset of the group?
I think, you know, we're still really positive. As you said, we've come really close. So we played Brisbane and Melbourne and played some good quarters and good halves. And then today, as Jazz said, the second half was good. So I think our mindset is that consistency. So how do we put four quarters together? And I think from the Brisbane game, we know that we're up at halftime. So our best is good enough. It's how we can do that for longer.
Geez, that was a fiery game, wasn't it? Did you get involved in any of that action?
The Brisbane one?
Yeah.
A little bit, actually. I had Batesy's back in the midfield, so if there's any words, I made sure I was there backing her up.
Yeah, well played. Well, Tilly and Jazz, thank you so much for having a chat. Enjoy the rest of the night and best of luck for the next month. Tilly Lucas-Rod and Jazz Fleming, everybody. All right, it is time now to get on with the count. Let's turn our attention to the screens for rounds 11 to 16.
In a seesawing contest with the Saints, it was hard to fathom the Hawks bridging the gap when they fell 20 points behind in the final quarter. But what followed was a showing of character and belief well beyond the years of this inspiring young group.
You boys want it deep. You see something in the pocket. It's perfectly way kick. Moore does play on here. The big finish.
Five unanswered goals lifted Hawthorn over the line in one of the more memorable come-from-behind wins we've seen.
Missed a couple of opportunities to make it four in a row for the Hawks. Kaczynski, huge kick this way. Kaczynski, two arms in the air. The Hawks from nowhere are in front with the last four.
But it was the extraordinary performance of one individual that would long live in the memories of the wider football world, with James Sicily playing the game of a lifetime. The sensational skipper earning a perfect 12 votes as he racked up 43 touches, which included 21 intercept possessions, 17 contested disposals, and 11 score involvements. It was the first of back-to-back wins for the Hawks in 2023, with Dylan Moore and John Newcomb also both influential in the result.
The Hawks in a big upset, they kick the last five.
The second place Power put on a show on their home deck in round 12 in a display very few teams would have been able to combat. Fortunately, the highlight of the day was won by the Hawks when the goal-kicking master Luke Bruce nailed his 500th career goal.
This time for 500, Luke Bruce brings it up, hand in the air. Small forward, big number, 500 goals to Lukey Bruce.
It was a fitting milestone for the three-time Premiership star as Punky went on to finish today with a bag of five, once again putting a smile on the face of Hawthorn fans, something he's become synonymous with over the journey of his sparkling 13-year career. Bruce would finish the day as the Hawks' best alongside Jarman Impey in a disappointing loss.
To a 49-point margin, so Port dominated the first half, Hawthorn dominated the second.
Attention quickly turned to taming the Lions on a Saturday afternoon at the G that very few football experts thought was achievable. A tough assignment was made even harder after digging a 17-point hole at half-time, but the hard-running Hawks were more than up to the task. Outworking the highly credentialed Brisbane on-ball brigade, Hawthorn smashed the Lions in uncontested possession count by more than 100 disposals. John Newcomb led the charge with 28 disposals, 5 clearances and 3 goal assists, while second-year Hawk Connor McDonald enjoyed a career-best game with 28 touches and 12 score involvements. It was an amazing win by this young group of Hawks.
He's going to have to thread it from Mighty Mouse to Lion Killer. The Hawks, with the last 4 goals of the afternoon, put a hammer blow through the Brisbane Lions and their hopes. Hawthorn by 25 points.
Following the mid-year bye, the Hawks hit the Gold Coast and were seemingly heating up as they booted the first 3 goals of the match, including a high-flying grab by Mitch Lewis. But sustaining that level against the Suns would prove too much, as the home side cruised to a 67-point victory. Will Day demonstrated his versatility through the middle and down back, playing a lone hand with 29 disposals and 9 marks, including 11 intercept possessions. The shade of purple was prominent right across the MCG for a powerful cause in round 16 as the club hosted its annual Dare to Hope match in memory of the late Paul Dear. With the Blues having plenty to play for, they outmatched the Hawks from the start to finish with a 10-goal result. Youngster Josh Ward was Hawthorn's most solid, finishing with 28 touches and 4 clearances.
Here against the Blues, earlier this season, the Hawks just keep fighting on.
Looking back at the leaderboard, we still have a relatively even race between 6 names after 16 rounds. While we have Day, Newcomb and Nash all still in the top 3, the gap remains minimal to the likes of Sicily, Impey and Warple. With the class between all these names, it's anyone's Peter Crimmins medal at this point.
So there you have it. The tables have turned slightly this time. It's Will Day in front by 2 votes there over Jai Newcomb, who obviously was our leader previously. A couple of cracking wins too during that period. Of course, James Sicily getting the 12 votes for that display, a ridiculous display really, when he had 21 intercept possessions and 11 score involvements as well as the 43 touches. So amazing stuff. And of course, that win against the Brisbane Lions. Well, tonight is not only about crowning the club's best and fairest player, but also about recognising the valuable contribution and achievements of other Hawks players across the season. The following awards have been decided by the coaching group based on their observations across the 2023 season. So to kick off the awards, it gives me great pleasure to welcome to the stage Cade Simpson to present the most promising player for 2023. Please make him welcome.
Thanks, Nat. So the most promising player this year is a first-year player. They debuted in round 7 against the Western Bulldogs. They played 17 games for the season. They kicked their first goal against Melbourne in round 9. And they were a Rising Star nomination against West Coast in round 10 with 28 disposals and 2 goals. So the winner of the Most Promising Award is Josh Weddle.
Oh, what a big fly! Weddle, down to McKenzie, big fly! Weddle drives it long and deep!
Get on board!
First goal for Weddle!
Smith skipped to centre-half forward, was slapped down by Foster. Foster, he follows up, which allows Weddle to bounce, to regather.
Weddle's got an opportunity for a second, and he takes it with absolute glee.
John, Josh, congratulations on this award. To claim this honour in just your first season is quite incredible. How do you reflect on your debut season?
It was really, really fun, and yeah, I couldn't think of it going a better way. So, yeah, it's really
okay. He's a man of few words. I see that. Another one for you then. Who's had the biggest impact on your football so far? Because you were highly touted. The club moved up the draft order to secure you. So who's had the biggest influence since you arrived?
A few people, definitely, like Cade Simpson, put me under his wing. Even Sis, the captain, it's been lots of help for me going through vision and stuff. So, and even my dad, always gives me a few tips, but not quite as helpful anymore, but he's always very supportive.
Excellent. Well, thank you. Is there anyone you'd like to thank?
I'd like to thank my girlfriend, Ella. My mum and dad who are here, and obviously the coaching staff and all my teammates as well. So thank you.
Well done. Thank you, Josh. Congratulations once again. Josh Weddle, your most promising player for 2023. All right, it now gives me great pleasure to welcome to the stage David Hale to present the most improved player.
A little bit higher. Evening all, it's great to see so many of the Brown and Gold family here tonight, and I trust you're all having a fantastic night. Gives me a great privilege this year to present the most improved player for 2023. This player had a flawless pre-season, which led into a great year. Teammates, coaches and fans expected a really high level of performance from this player week in, week out. And it's my pleasure to congratulate Connor Nash on being there.
Good. Big tackle. Nash, he's not a man you want to get run down by.
There's your 6'5" spinning out of a tackle.
Nash, wing guard.
Congratulations. What was your mindset coming into this season? What were your goals and what did you want to achieve this year?
Yeah, I suppose getting a full pre-season as a midfielder was the main focus, really. And I suppose every year you come back and your place is still up for grabs, and certainly mine wasn't settled. So got about getting to work at the start of the year with Haley as a midfield coach. It was good fun. So I suppose it was just the start, was getting a game, I suppose. Round one, I wasn't in the team, so from there I was able to build, and that was the focus.
Well, talk to me about that move to the midfield, because how did it come about, and what was it about that role that you managed to thrive so well on?
Yeah, I suppose a few years ago my career was at the crossroads, and I was Sam Mitchell and Andy Collins said, yeah, let's throw you in the midfield. I suppose you're a bigger fella and see how you go in there, and it was from there that I was able to, I suppose, use my strengths, that being a taller fella who could move around the place. So I've enjoyed it ever since, and looking to improve since then.
Well, we've loved watching you play in the midfield. Is it true your mum and dad are here tonight?
Yeah, mum and dad are, yeah. Yeah, they're sitting down there. I can see them there. Mum Bernadette and Dad Tony. So they've come a long way for this, and certainly enjoying the night so far. And we'll be here for the rest of the night, long into the night.
Amazing. Is there anyone you'd like to thank?
Yeah, I suppose those two have been the main pillars growing up in that, and been the main support as well. My partner Grace is sitting down there as well, along with her mum Linda, who fills in throughout the year, getting to a lot of games, and my coaches and teammates. So, thank you all, and enjoy the rest of the night.
Thanks, Connor. Congratulations. Connor Nash, everyone. Most improved player. All right, if you could now welcome to the stage Adrian Hickmott to present the most courageous player for 2023.
Good evening, everyone. The most courageous award. There's a couple of ways you can win this, or that can be achieved. So head over the footy, putting your head over the footy when the time's right, and to go hard at the football. And another one, when you run all day, and you just keep running and running and running for your team. So I'm proud to mention or commend most courageous player is Dylan Moore.
Kept on coming, Moore. Show that he could step out a goal. And just what the Hawks needed.
First goal of the night tonight. Dylan Moore opens up the face and he puts it straight through.
Special award to win. What does it mean to be judged by your peers as the most courageous?
Yeah, to be honest, I don't really know. I go out there every week and I love the club, I love the boys I play with. So to be honest, I just go out there every week just putting my head over the footy because I love the boys, I love the club, and all I want to be is a premiership player. So everything I can do for the boys is just looking for that goal.
Music to a lot of people's ears. We saw you take a really important leadership position this season, co-vice-captain. You even captained a couple of games in James Sicily's absence. What has that experience taught you?
Yeah, it was great. I'm none from three as captain, so I'm not going so well, but I felt like I put a lot of pressure on myself as when I was VC or as captain, and I now know that I don't need to do that. And I see what Sicily goes through every week and it's pretty tough. He asks a lot for us, and now I'll never say no to him because I know when I was captain, if I asked a question and someone said no, I was getting pretty angry at them. So whenever he asks me something, I'll always say yes.
So you're now a yes person?
Pretty much.
Okay, good. Good to know. Is there anyone you'd like to thank?
Yeah, I guess I would like to thank my family. My mum and dad are here. Thanks for your support. My two sisters, Sarah and Emma, thank you. And then my sister who lives in London, if she's watching, Casey, thank you for supporting me. But that's about it. Thanks.
Congratulations, Dylan. We've loved watching your career unfold. Well done.
Thank you.
Dylan Moore, everyone, your most courageous player. All right, time now to welcome to the stage Andy Collins to present Best Clubman.
Thanks, Nat. Being a past player of the 80s, I get 10 minutes, unlike everyone else. Big shout out straight away, Ray Wilson, my first coach at Hawthorn's in the room. Bob Keddy, my Sandringham Premiership coach in 1971, four goals last quarter. We don't win the 71 grand final without Bob Keddy. Big shout out to Bob. Tucky, the most selfish man I know, with seven premierships. But my captain, always my captain, and Russell Green, my mentor, taught me everything I knew about small back. So shout out to these guys. Best Clubman Award goes to somebody who gives time. He makes others better. He makes the team better. He makes our club better. Coaches and mentors young players. He shares leadership advice to our coach and our captain. Cares greatly about his performance and our team's performance. He understands and embraces the responsibilities of a Hawthorn player and understands it goes beyond the field. He makes sure that he thanks people for those that support and love our footy club as he does. His kindness and humility does frustrate me, though, when my wife says, why can't you be more like Luke? Best clubman, Luke Bruce.
It's time for 500. Luke Bruce brings it up, hand in the air. Small forward, big number, 500 goals to Lukey Bruce.
And a long career, Luke Bruce, to ice the game for the Hawks. Bruce from directly in front. Luke Bruce was never going to miss.
Joey. Bruce.
Listen to the Hawks fans now.
Best clubman. You've been here for about 14 years, so it's probably thoroughly deserved, but what does that mean to you?
Yeah, oh, it's obviously a huge honour. The day that I call at work driving out to Waverley is the day that I probably should retire. So I drive out on the Monash every day, wanting these boys to get better. I want to put in as much effort as I can to make sure that they do that, and every minute that I'm at the footy club, I want these boys to improve and get the success that they want. And I've been fortunate enough to experience that myself, but I want this group to do that as well.
Is that what keeps you going and keeps you coming back for more pre-seasons and pre-seasons and sticking around at the club, obviously?
Yeah, absolutely. I stood in this room a few weeks ago when we had a 10-year reunion from the 2013 Premiership, and those memories absolutely wonderful and pretty special memories for me, and I want these young guys in front of me to experience that. And as Sam said before, some of the texts that we got on Grand Final Day about the motivation and the drive that these guys have to want to be out there on the last day in September is pretty special, and it's what keeps me going.
You've obviously done it all, premierships, all Australians, but this year too you marked a nice little milestone with your 500th snag, and I don't want you to run through every single goal for us, but when you reflect on the season, that must have been a really nice moment for you.
Yeah, it was. It might have been 18 months ago, I sort of marked down 500 goals and 300 games were two goals that I'd... they probably weren't on the radar initially, but obviously as the longer you go, you start to reevaluate your goals and start to sort of tick them off. So for me, those two goals were on the horizon. So to tick the 500 goal milestone off was pretty special. As I said, it's not something I thought about or anything like that when I first started my career. So to tick it off and be mentioned in amongst the names that I've been mentioned against are pretty special, and haven't really reflected too much at the moment, but I'm sure once I'm done, I will and really appreciate it.
Can we get you to 600 or no?
Maybe not 600, hopefully 300 games and we'll see how we go.
Thank you so much. Is there anyone you'd like to thank?
Yeah, absolutely. I'd like to thank my beautiful wife sitting here in front of me, Anthea. She's an absolute rock for me, and the support she gives me is the reason I get to do what I do every week. Mum and Dad are in the crowd tonight, over near the Nashes, I think. So I've been told by the Nash parents to, Nashy, can you kick a few more goals? Apparently 4 a.m. in the morning, it's a bit more exciting if you kick goals instead of just giving little handballs out and stoppages. So can you do that next year? And then to all you guys here, you guys are a special part of this journey, and you guys need to really jump on board over the next few years, because I feel like this group's going somewhere special.
Yes, I love it. Thank you, Luke. Congratulations once again. Luke Bruce, everybody, your best clubman. Now to present the Lethal Award. Now, this award recognises a player who is the ultimate teammate and voted on by the players themselves. Please welcome last year's winner, Jai Newcombe, to present the 2023 Lethal Award.
Thanks, Nat. As a club and a playing group, we have a pyramid of values that, when carried out, will enable us to form on any stage throughout the year. Those being love, standards, effort, mentality, method, and execution. Each week as players, we vote on who we think best displayed these values throughout the game and throughout the season. These votes are accumulated to the end of the year. This year's winner has got the recognition for his love across the team, for celebrating the little things on game day and the efforts of other teammates. His mindset and mentality to be able to play any position on the ground and fill any role that is needed of the team on game day. I think the most pleasing thing this year for him has been to find the balance between not only trying to be a leader but a consistent performer on game day and executing when we need him. So please join me in congratulating the 2023 Lethal Award winner in Will Day.
Will Day, who's had an outstanding year as a midfielder.
This guy, he's going to be a superstar of the competition, Will Day.
Inside 50, Day, faked one way, and then goes for home. Congratulations on the Lethal Award, voted by your teammates. How does this one sit with you?
Yeah, I think this one being peer voted, and it's definitely something that you want to have the respect of all your teammates, and when you go out with them, you want to know that they can rely on you week in, week out, which has definitely been something that I wanted to work on this year. So to be recognised with this is, yeah, pretty special.
So when you say you wanted to work on it this year, what was it that you went into the mindset each game? What were the things that you wanted to do?
Yeah, Jai mentioned it just before. Probably previous years, I was thinking about leadership a little bit too much and probably going a bit too quick. And at the end of last year, sort of sat down with Sam and Adrian Hickmott as well and sort of realised that performing on game day is a great start to good leadership. So yeah, really focus on that this year, and yeah, it paid off.
Well, thanks, Will. Congratulations. Is there anyone you'd like to thank?
Yeah, just all the boys for voting me. Yeah, very honoured to win this from you guys, and my parents as well are here tonight. So thanks all that you do for me, and yeah, have a good night.
Congratulations, Will. Will Day, this year's Lethal Award recipient. A big round of applause, of course, for all of our winners here tonight. Congratulations to each and every one of you. Absolutely fantastic. If we can give them one more round of applause, please. So while his time in the brown and gold might have been brief, Max Lynch's impact on his teammates and coaches has been huge. A fun, loving character with a work ethic to match, Lynch overcame a myriad of challenging injuries to represent Hawthorn 8 times over 2 seasons after crossing over from Collingwood at the end of 2021. Unfortunately, his career was cut short this season, with the talented ruckman forced to call time following advice from an independent concussion panel. Tonight, we want to celebrate Max's contribution to our club as he departs in a playing capacity, at least for now. So if you could please welcome retiree Max Lynch to the stage, everybody.
And then the centering kick was the right option. Big Max Lynch on his own. Oh, yet to kick a goal in the big time. Max Lynch has got his first AFL goal right there.
Brilliantly by O'Meara. Coming up again, Lynch, who think this is the best game in the world. 2 goals and a couple of kicks for Lynch.
Super impressive in the first half. He got the first touch of the second. Here he goes again. The way he crossed his crew of the way. Here's Lynch. Lynch in the congestion. Lynch is coming around. It's a goal for the Hawks.
Lynch can keep it in.
overcoat for this man. Gets inside 50, thinks about the goal, then does the disciplined thing towards Gunston. Does it wonderfully well.
Max Lynch, everybody. Max, the first thing we both notice is that luscious mullet. Man, do you miss it?
I do every now. I feel a lot lighter now, but got every single one of my entire highlights as well on the tape, which was pretty good as well.
Well, how do you feel watching back on some of those highlights, and how do you reflect on your time at Hawthorn?
Well, I've loved my time at Hawthorn. It's sort of a little bit bittersweet. I would have liked to have more of an impact on the field, and I suppose that's not the way it went, but yeah, I've loved my time at Hawthorn and feel like I've had more of an impact around the group, and I'm really thankful for that.
It has been a really tough year for you. How are you feeling now?
Yeah, great. Everything's going well, which is, I suppose, what the precautionary act was for, to sort of pull the pin before it maybe potentially went a different way. But the support and love that I've felt from the group and everyone sort of put their arm around me made it a lot easier, which was really great.
Well, talk me through that time. How difficult was it to, I guess, come to terms with not being able to play footy anymore?
Yeah, there was a lot of hard days, if I'm honest, but I'm extremely fortunate that I've got a lot of strong people around me and got a lot of love from my friends and my family and my partner Izzy, which really guided me along the way. A lot of days where I was quite unsure and was really heartbroken, I suppose, but having those people around me just made the whole experience a lot easier.
Now, I hear you hosted the red carpet this evening, is that correct?
Yeah.
How did that go? Are you ready to take over my job now, and did you learn anything interesting about your teammates?
I was a shambles the entire time. I had to check my notes to make sure I got all the right questions. Actually, even Izzy took over for me at one point as well, so yeah. Got a couple of good answers, which I'm sure you'll see in the highlights, but no, I don't think I'm quite ready to take over the MC role.
Okay, all right. Well, we'll check them out on what, hawthornfc.com.au, is that the plug? Or
yeah.
On the socials, and we'll check it out later. I'm sure there are some people you would like to thank, Max, for throughout your career, so the floor's yours.
Yeah, like I said originally, like without Izzy, I would have been a wreck throughout the past 2 years, so having her as my rock has been, massive for me. I won't say too much more, I'll get emotional. But
okay. Yeah,
also my mum and dad, obviously the entire time as well, having them by my side, making long trips from Albury. Westy, the doc, has been a massive help for me along the journey as well. And Sam and Rob and things like that, just making me feel like, you know, there's no rush to try and push back when I knew I wasn't right, that sort of thing. So a massive thanks to the club and especially all my teammates as well, where I'm a big hugger, so always give me a cuddle and stuff when I need it as well. So, yeah, can't thank everyone here enough. So, love is all.
Thank you. You'll always be part of the Hawthorn family. Max, best of luck with the next chapter as well. And we look forward to seeing you grow as a coach in our AFLW program too. So, thank you very much.
Thanks again. Thanks, Sam.
Max Lynch, everybody, please, another round of applause. Now, before we head into the dessert break, we would also like to acknowledge two former Hawks who also hung up the boots this year. And despite finishing their careers at other clubs, we won't hold it against them, these two will always hold a very, very special place in our hearts.
Number 23, Lance Franklin. Number 16, Isaac Smith.
It's dangerous to say, I won't do anything. He has done the impossible.
We've never seen it before. Here's Smith. Around one, around two, and back. Isaac Smith.
We're trying to get through Russell Swan. Well, great tackle. That came from Franklin.
Rolling back in. This man is in great form. Gunston was flying. Look at Isaac Smith. Just turns it on.
They've got Lincoln Guerra. Big play here. Stratton run down, but okay. Franklin with a hurdle. And then the long one. This will be something. It is. It's an MCG special.
Running Smith. Look at centre square. Second bounce. They let him go inside 50. Frawley didn't make a decision. And Smith goes in and kicks the goal. Neither one thing nor the other.
Schoen makers, big fly. Smith in the pocket. Clever. Oh, better than clever.
brilliant.
Towards the wing. Buddy Franklin goes back. Advantage is paid. It's a one-man back pass. He's away. Running now towards the 50. Can he do it again? Man running back towards the goal square. Needs to be closer. He can't bounce it through. He kicks it through on the full.
He winds himself up. Gee, it's a good kick. It is a great kick. It's one for the ages. 5 seconds down.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the Peter Crimmins Medal Count. If you can all please take your seats, we've got to get on with the business part of the evening. We need to crown our best and fairest winner for 2023. So if you can please take your seats, that would be absolutely fantastic. I'll give you about 30 seconds. Thank you, everyone. If you can take your seats, otherwise I'm going to have to start naming and shaming Josh Ward. I'm looking at you. Sit down. Sam Frost, also looking at you. All right, everyone, we want to get along and find out who is our Peter Crimmins medalist for 2023. So appreciate you all want to catch up. Plenty of time to do that after the count. Thank you, everyone. All right, well, we finished off our last round with the highlights of rounds 10 to 16. So let's take a look now at what happened over the next month of footy.
A hardened Hawthorn outfit travelled to Sydney to face the Orange team for a round 17 showdown. It was a physical contest from the get-go. The usual suspects of Day, Nash and Newcomb found themselves right in the thick of it. But it was Finn McGuinness who was Hawthorn's most influential in his first game since round 4, keeping Giant star Josh Kelly to just 6 disposals in a magnificent shutdown role. Sadly, it was Greater Western Sydney who would reign supreme, recording a narrow 13-point victory.
Just has to get ball to boot. And he's the man for that. Significant opposition, much better opposition from Hawthorn.
A rematch with the Roos was up next, and it was the Hawks with a point to prove in the attempt to grab both wins from the Roos in season 2023. Chances were aplenty for the Brown and Gold, and if it wasn't for some inaccurate kicking, the eventual margin of 48 points might have been larger for Hawthorn in its biggest win at Marvel Stadium since 2019. Newcomb and Warple got their hands dirty with 33 and 32 disposals respectively, as well as 7 clearance apiece, while the class of Carl Amon was on full display, with 33 disposals of his own, including 8 inside 50s and a whopping 813 metres gained.
It's the Hawks' biggest win at Marvel in 4 years. And Sam Mitchell's men just starting to spread their wings as we turn for the final stages of this long season.
Hawthorn was dealt a crushing blow in round 19, falling to Richmond by the narrowest of margins in a final term Brown and Gold fans would rather forget. For the three quarters prior, the Hawks were sublime. James Sicily, the control of the match, with 15 intercept possessions and 13 marks, seeing him earn a perfect 12 votes for the second time this season. Newcomb and Warple were also among the votes, while Chad Wingard reminded us all of his very best, with 17 damaging disposals, including 3 goals and 9 score involvements.
It's rolling, it's home! Oh, Wingard's having an afternoon at the MCG. Time's going to run out. The Tigers with a barnstorming finish.
A slow start against the Saints led to scenes similar to those of yesteryear as Sam Mitchell delivered an old-fashioned quarter-time spray to his young team. While it kicked the Hawks into gear, it was a margin too large to bridge as St Kilda extracted revenge for its loss earlier in the season. Luke Bruce continued his strong goal-kicking form with a bag of 6, while Will Day and Chad Wingard finished with 2 majors each, along with plenty of footy to see them among the votes.
Luke, that is magnificent!
the 25-year-old debutant Brandon Ryan. First goal in AFL footy. And welcome to the big time, Sticks Ryan.
Here we go, they've traded the lead all night. Now just a single vote separates our top two. Jai Newcombe and Will Day are moving away from the pack following round 20, but it's still an extraordinarily close count. Connor Nash's consistent campaign is him keeping pace with the leaders, along with James Warple on 88 votes, while the skipper's still in with a chance for a repeat crown. With four rounds to go, every vote will be crucial.
Jai Newcombe back on top. The top three look pretty tight. I think this is going to go down to the wire. It is time now, though, to relive my favourite win of the season, round 21.
A retro round to remember for the Brown and Gold, as the Big Hawk made a big statement against the ladder leading Pies in arguably the upset of the season. Absorbing every challenge Collingwood threw at them, the Hawks were both clinical and gutsy, pulling off a 32-point win. In another captain's performance, James Sicily racked up 37 disposals and took 19 marks in his second perfect 12-vote game in 3 weeks. Finn McGuinness cemented his status as the league's premier shutdown specialist, putting the clamp on Brownlow Medal favourite Nick Dacos. McGuinness awarded 9 votes for his efforts, along with Day, Newcombe and Nash, who all added to their tally.
The Nuke and deliver the bomb to send them 6 down, swooping like he's back in all Australian form. It's Lewis's turn! This is an inspired outfit! Morrison's got a good look and a good strike!
Well, Don't tell me!
Mitch Lewis! Sam Mitchell, for all his glory as a player, this is one of his finest moments as a coach. Simply stunning the Hawks.
Our leaders continue to trade blow for blow, with just the slimmest of margins separating Newcombe and Day with 3 rounds to go. While they look to be the ones to beat from here, Nash is hot on their heels, followed closely by Warple and Sicily, who are all capable of producing big vote polling games.
What a cracking day at the MCG that was. And how about Finn McGuinness, the 9 votes there for the job that he did on Nick Dacos. I reckon that deserves a round of applause, everybody. All right. So I think it's fair to say the top three look pretty set. I'm just not sure of the order at this point. But I've only got a couple of rounds left to go. So let's take a look now at what happened in round 22.
Hawks added another big scalp in the Bulldogs as they continued their impressive run of end-of-year upsets. In Game 50, Jai Newcombe lifted to an extraordinary new level in his first perfect 12-vote game of his young career. A wrecking ball in the contest with plenty of class on the outside to match, he was enormous on his way to 40 disposals and 10 score involvements, including a goal of his own. Carl Amon was instrumental with 704 metres gained, while Will Day, Connor Nash and Blake Hardwick all collected votes. For the race has heated up. While Newcombe's perfect 12 has seen him pull away ever so slightly, It's important to note he does miss a game in the final two rounds. Day is just 5 votes behind, with Nash a further 10 back from him. Warple and Sicily in the mix still, with anyone in this group still in contention right now.
Newcombe, 5 votes ahead of Will Day at this point. This is going to be such a tight finish. 2 games to go. Who is going to be crowned our best and fairest winner? Don't worry, I'm not going to drag out the suspense for much longer, so let's get straight back into the count.
Building upon recent performances, the Hawks took it right up to another premiership contender, Melbourne, in round 23, and were just 2 points behind at the half. But the class of the Demons will see them break the deadlock following the main break, running out 27-point winners at the G. James Warple was the top vote getter for the Brown and Gold with 7 votes. Connor Nash received 6, while an uncharacteristic quiet game from Will Day saw him earn just 3 votes. And suddenly, we have a 3-horse race with just 1 game to go. Despite missing round 23, Newcombe has clung on to a 2-vote lead ahead of Will Day, while Connor Nash has made this incredibly interesting, closing in on our leading duo and is just 9 votes off the pace. Ladies and gentlemen, brace yourselves as we get ready to head into the final round of the 2023 season. Meeting against Fremantle had the potential to go one of two ways, and after the Dockers got the jump on the Hawks, it was always going to be a lead incredibly hard to peg back. Dylan Moore was Hawthorn's best, gathering 27 touches and booting a goal in the eventual 37-point defeat to the Dockers. Will Day put in a strong showing to close the year with 30 possessions and 6 clearances, while John Newcombe hit the scoreboard with a major next to his name, along with 23 disposals. And it would be remiss not to mention another solid outing from Connor Nash with 23 disposals, 6 tackles and 5 clearances. So now, as we've all been waiting for, let's find out our top 3 award winners and who will be crowned our 2023 Peter Crimmins Medal winner.
I would now like to welcome onto the stage Coach Sam Mitchell to present the awards for third place and runner-up. Please make him welcome. Time to end the suspense. On 114 votes, making his debut on the best and fairest stage, third place goes to Connor Nash.
Webster ran into a block of granite. Sends it to McDonald. Good grab.
There's your 6-for-5, a spinning out of a tackle.
Nash.
Oh, that's working pretty well.
Congratulations, a stunning season. We spoke earlier when you won the most improved, but last year you finished 12th in the Peter Crimmins medal count. You must be so proud of how far you've come and grown over the last 12 months.
Yeah, definitely happy to be standing here, but it was a lot of hard work, I suppose, this year. And got there with David Hale and Adrian Hickmont as 2 real close coaches and the rest of my coaching group. So, just very happy to be standing here and looking forward to what next year brings. It's a really exciting group, and it's certainly a really exciting time to be at Hawthorn the next few years.
Certainly will be. The consistency for you was really key this year. What was the secret to that for you? What changed?
Didn't really change too much other than going back to it each week. What am I good at? I suppose a bit taller as a midfielder, and what can I improve on each week? And being that bigger physical presence inside, and maybe do a bit more of the dirty work and let the likes of Will Day and Joy Newcomb and Warps do the fancy work around the stoppages. I'll do the other stuff around there. But just going back to that each week and helping out the team in any way I can, really.
I know you thanked some people before, but is there anyone else you'd like to thank, or just ditto from last time?
Yeah, I suppose it is a big ditto from last time. Certainly the parents and mum and dad again, I'll say that, to Bernadette and Tony sitting down there. Partner Grace there has been a rock all year. I suppose not having the family support around me right there next to me all year has been massive. So really appreciate you, Grace, so thank you. Again, her mother, her Linda's been to a lot of games throughout the year and filled in for mum and dad. And then, my coaches, and I suppose Sam's been a massive part of that the last few years. So I suppose, as I said, my career was at a crossroads a few years ago. And yourself and Andy Collins and a few others have been instrumental in helping me get back to you. So I really appreciate that. Thank you.
Congratulations, Connor. A fantastic season with the club. Can't wait to see what 2024 brings.
Looking forward to it. Let's go.
All right. Now time out for our 2023 Peter Crimmins Medal runner-up. Finishing with 123 votes, Jai Newcomb.
To Morrison. Oh, that's a clash. Whiteman's come in. With Newcomb, this guy won't. Twisting, turning Bailey Smith inside out, and then delivering to Lewis.
A 37 point lead in the last quarter. They've brought out the nuke and deliver the ball to
Meek. Flies, palms it. Newcomb out the front, spears it just over the
head. Combination. If anyone can from 55, it's Newcomb with a blast.
Jai, it was such a close finish. Another outstanding season from yourself, following on from last year, really. How do you reflect on 2023?
It's obviously been, I guess, a sort of career best year for me this year as well, improving on last year. It's been, I guess, pleasing to be able to perform well and consistently throughout the year. There's a lot of positives to take out of this season.
So many positives, because we saw some extraordinary performances from yourself. I think down in Tassie against the Dogs, round 22, it was 40 touches and a goal. What did you do differently this season to elevate your game and take it to that next level?
I think Adrian Hickmont played a pretty big part in sort of taking my game to the next level this year. Sort of had him as my mentor coach this year and dove pretty deep into what's going to make me a good player and the things that are already making me a good player and making them sort of real elite strengths in the game. So I probably owe a lot to him for this year and obviously my teammates as well in making it a very, very easy place to come into work and get the most out of myself.
Oh, we absolutely love watching you play. Is there anyone that you would like to thank tonight?
There is obviously my partner Georgia has played a massive role in keeping me grounded and being a great partner over the last 3 years. So thank you to you. My mum and dad, massive efforts this year to come to, I think, all bar one game. So can't thank them enough. Thank them enough for their support throughout the year. And my sister and the rest of my family is here tonight. Thank you very much for your ongoing support. And thanks for coming. obviously to all the Hawks fans here in the room tonight, thank you. Thank you very much for all the contributions you make and coming out and watching us every week. Obviously, we don't have the season to turn out tonight like we do without you guys. And then just a couple of personal ones for me. And obviously, ASICS, I cop a lot of flack from the boys and how many deliveries I get. But thank you very much. And to Northern this and more recently as well for a nice new Nissan X-Trail. But other than that, thanks everyone for coming tonight and enjoy the rest of your night.
Congratulations, Jai. You should be so very proud of the outstanding season you have had. And now to present the 2023 Peter Crimmins Medal, it is my pleasure to introduce to the stage Gwen Crimmins. In first place, finishing with 125 votes, please join me in congratulating your Hawthorn Football Club best and fairest player for 2023, the Peter Crimmins medalist, Will Day. Give me
something. He's going to be a superstar of the competition, so Will Day.
My son, but Will's grandfather played football with my husband, Robert Day, number 12. Congratulations.
Thank you, Gwen. Appreciate that. Will, come over here. There you go. Wow. It was a tight finish in the end. How were the nerves?
Yeah, the last few games were sort of stacking up and... I was trying to do the math in my head a little bit and I thought Nuke was going to get it, but yeah.
I know you were excited, but no one in this room was more excited than Dylan Moore, who is currently filming at this point. One of your biggest cheerleaders?
Yeah, he's having a good one tonight. but yeah, he's been great for me all throughout the year.
I think he's had a start at the races earlier today. And now, your permanent move into the midfield was obviously a big talking point this year. You had a big pre-season in preparation for it. Can you give us an insight into the move and how you found your confidence and feet in that role?
Yeah, had a few conversations at the end of last year. Was going okay, but definitely not anywhere near what both the coaches and I thought I could be at. So... having some honest conversations and putting some things into practice was really important for me, and to have a good run at pre-season as well was also huge.
What were those honest conversations like? They're not always easy, are they? Did it take a while to kind of come to terms with some of those things?
Yeah, I guess when you hear them at the time, you probably don't like it, but it probably took until the end of the year and over the off-season until it really did click, and I think that's something that our club, I'm really grateful for, that we can have those conversations and we know that it's all because we want everyone to be better. So the love within the group's been great.
What is it about this club that is so special and that you love and makes you absolutely love coming to work every single day?
Yeah, I think as I just touched on, just the love between the whole group, but not just the players, but the staff as well. So everyone that works at the club, we've got a great connection with upstairs as well. So I think just coming in and knowing you can be yourself at the club and, it's just awesome to come in every day.
I mean, Gwen mentioned it before, but your grandfather won a premiership with the club back in 1971. This must be such a special family connection too for you. Does that mean, I guess, does this mean a little bit more because of that?
Yeah, I think the whole journey is knowing Grandpa played and coming into my locker each day and seeing his name above it as well is pretty special. So, yeah, it's great.
Will, you've had such an incredible year. Congratulations. I'm sure there are people you would like to thank.
Yeah, first of all, just the coaching staff, Sam and Storm with the move into the midfield this year. It's been a great transition, and those conversations that I've talked about, I'm really grateful for them, and you definitely didn't go easy on me, which is great. To Adrian Hickmott and Rob McCartney, you guys have just given me the self-belief this year that it was nothing like that 12 months ago, so I do really appreciate everything you guys do for me. I will give a shout out to Maury as well. All through this year, you've set the standard for me for training standards and how to be truly elite, but you're an even better mate, so thank you very much. To Mum and Dad back there, I wouldn't be anywhere near here without you guys and just the opportunities you've created for me, just with the upbringing I've had, I've really appreciated it. I'll also have to mention my two younger sisters who aren't here, but they won't. I won't hear the end of it if I don't say anything. So I love you guys. And then to the boys as well, I'm just really excited about where we're going. As Sam said, when we were going through a rough patch, not one of us had the doubts at all. And I think we all know where we're heading. And yeah, I'm really excited to be a part of it. So thanks to you guys.
Congratulations once again, everybody, your Peter Crimmins medalist, Will Day. And ladies and gentlemen, your top three best and fairest for 2023. If you are able, could you please stand and charge your glasses as we toast the winner for the 2023 Peter Crimmins medal, Will Day, runner-up Jai Newcomb, and third place Connor Nash. Now, congratulations to the three of you. Before we do take a look at the final leaderboard, Will, I need you to come back here because you're going to help me draw our $100 winner. Make it a good one, please. All right, read it out.
The winner is number 47.
Number 47, congratulations, you are off to Bali, seven nights in Bali. I'm pretty sure, is that Emma Race? That is Emma Race, all right, congratulations. Let's take a look now at how we finished up after the votes were all tallied at the end of the season. And this is the final leaderboard. If you take a look at this, this is your top 10 for 2023. As I mentioned, Will Day on 125, Jai Newcomb 123, Connor Nash, then you had James Warple coming in fourth, James Sicily there, the skipper with 101 votes, Dylan Moore in sixth spot, Jarman Impey, Carl Amon, Blake Hardwick, and Luke Bruce to round out the top 10 of this year's Peter Crimmins medal count. Now, for those of you that entered the forecast of the finishers competition, we have a winner tonight, and the winner is Shane Sartori. So Shane, if you are still here, you have won a beautiful prize, so make sure you head out to the registration desk to pick that up. So congratulations. Our raffle winners are going to be displayed on the screen in just a second, so if you have one of those is your lucky number, then congratulations, your prize can be collected from the registration desk at the foyer. So congratulations for that. And for anyone that was successful in the ballot bidding, you will have already been contacted via text message, so just see the friendly staff from Helping Hands to collect your items. Congratulations to all of tonight's winners. That brings us to the end of the formalities for the 2023 Peter Crimmins Medal. A big thank you to all the event staff here at Hawthorn and Crown Palladium for putting on such a fabulous night. They do an amazing job. Nicole, of course, and the team, Sophie and the other Nicole. So thank you to all of them. We have a DJ with us here tonight. You might see Andy Gowers on the dance floor a little bit later on. DJ Ava David is almost ready to go on centre stage, so make sure you finish off the night with a dance. Thank you so much for attending the 2023 Peter Crimmins Medal. I hope you have enjoyed the night. Get home safely. And, of course, go Hawks.